Harih Om. Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harih Om.
How the other religions, I'm talking about Christianity and Islam and the Jews, they say that don't worship idols. So in Hinduism, we do have something resembling idols, but how would you respond to this in a robust way?
Okay, I mean, the Abrahamic tradition have a habit of challenging Hindus with the following two major challenges. They say, first of all, you are a polytheist tradition, means believing lots of ultimate realities, gods, oh, all these colorful gods and goddesses. That means it's contradictory to common sense. You can't have more than one. So the first thing they say, you are a polytheist tradition, many gods. And Hindus say, oh, we have all the Shiva and Vishnu, all that. In reality, we have never been a polytheist tradition. We have always been a very mature, very grand, very well thought out, very structured, pluralistic tradition. I've been rubbing this in fact, I did a session at the parliament, in British parliament, a couple of weeks back, and I said, this is the main thing that you have to adopt from Hinduism. Many ways to be spiritual, many ways to think of ultimate reality. It's called pluralism. If all other religions adopt this idea, then the fighting in the name of religion will stop immediately, because they say, oh, this is my way of thinking about ultimate reality. This is Mr. Lakhani's way of thinking ultimate reality. So be it. Why do you want to fight and, you know, thump each other for no reason? So the central feature of our tradition is pluralism. So what appears as a weakness, polytheism, is in fact a grand idea suited to the societies of today, so that people of different religions can coexist honestly and with full love and dedication to their own tradition without thumping each other. Pluralism, not polytheism. That's the first challenge. The second challenge I get, and I am tired of it, but I still have to handle it, is that you are idolatrous. And you know, even the Jews, they hate the word idolatry. They say, in fact, if you got a Jew and you say you want to take him to a temple with all these images, he won't come in. I'm telling you, you'll be surprised. The Muslim might come in, but the Jew won't come in, saying, no, thy shall Lord create graven images of thy God, says our tradition. So I'm not going to come in. I got this experience. I was surprised, very intellectual, intelligent Jewish personality, academic, wasn't prepared to enter a temple. I said, fair enough. What's going on? You see, the Hindu tradition is very magnanimous. It says, in order to engage with spirituality, use every tool that is possible, including the idea of giving form, name and form, to the idea of ultimate reality, different names and forms, not many gods, many ways to think of ultimate reality. Giving different names and forms to the same ultimate reality, pluralism, not stopping there, going a stage further and saying, why don't we also be magnanimous and give it form? Give it form. Why are we so frightened of giving form? Because we all have form. Let's think of ultimate reality also with a form. We are not apologizing for it at all. This is the way we relate to ultimate reality, spirituality, saying, give it name and form, different names and form, same ultimate, but different names and form. So we allow the idea that you can give form to the ultimate reality. This is called Sagun Sakar Ishwar, with qualities and with attributes and with form. We allow for it. So we say, now let's create all this kind of lovely, colorful imagery. What's wrong with it? We all use this. In order to relate to subtle ideas, you require some kind of figure or some kind of, you know, imagery or some kind of symbolism. You can't do without it. And then people say, Mr. Lakhani, it's not true. You shouldn't convert into this great infinite God. Cannot be reduced to this finite form. It's infinite. You can't do this. Horrible. I said, no, it's not horrible. I said, in every field, we have this idea of trying to relate to subtle ideas using some kind of symbolism. In every field, including mathematics. You can't do your mathematics without using symbols X, Y, Z. They have no meaning. They have no reality. Yet you use them to manipulate and come to understanding subtle ideas using X, Y, Z. And the most important symbol in mathematics, infinite. It's infinite. And you say, oh, no, Mr. Lakhani, you put a little twiddle on the blackboard. Say, this is infinite. That's not infinite. That's a symbol you create to relate to the idea of infinite. You use it in mathematics without any hassle. Without it, you can't do mathematics. And yet, when Hindus say you want to give form to God, say, no, you can't do it. It's infinite. Infinite has got to be given a symbol. So why can't we think of ultimate reality as with this colorful imagery? We love it. We are not apologizing for it whatsoever. It's a better way of engaging with spirituality, because you give it form. You can love a personality rather than say, oh, subtle principle, you know. So this is why we are not apologizing for it. So if somebody uses, be careful. If somebody uses the word idol, run away from it straight away. Idol means you are worshipping objects. We never do that. Ask any Hindu who has gone to a temple, did you say, oh, marble, we love you? They say, no, we say, mom, ultimately, our God, we love you. See, we are not worshipping objects. That's called idolatry. We can say we use images And if you like symbols to relate to the ultimate reality, they are called pratik and pratima, from the root prati, going towards spirituality using pratik, symbols, or pratima, imagery. We are not apologizing. In fact, the word we use for the images we use in temple is called murti. Murti is a beautiful word. It says giving a material status to spirit. See, we are very clear about it. Giving a material form to the spirit, which is very subtle, but we give it material, murti, murta. So we give it a material form. See how powerful and well thought out your tradition is. So everybody challenges you with polytheism or idolatry, fire back his idea.
Why did God create people on so many different levels? So you got some people who've got very high IQ, some people mid-range, and then you got some people with very low IQ. And yet we are all creations of, you know, the ultimate reality.
Manikaji, you always ask such difficult questions. And of course, what I do is I throw the question that God has asked him. He made it. I have no idea why he did the medicine's variation. And this is a lighthearted response. But the more philosophic response is as follows. It says, when you think of ultimate reality as a super personality, we are in trouble with lots of issues like this. Why such variation? Why such injustice in this world? Some people do hard work and suffer all the time. Some people are nasty and they enjoy their life thoroughly. So why such unjust world? Why did God create such unjust worlds? We have serious issue. So the only way you can respond philosophically, honestly, to say, when you think of ultimate reality as a super personality, the super personality is in trouble. When you look at the world around you, he's in trouble straight away, including this question. Why variation? Why some up and some down? Why some animal and why some human? Why some good human and why some bad human? Why, oh why? The answer is, when you think of ultimate reality as a super personality, we are in trouble. When you think of ultimate reality as a principle, you are safe. Because you can say ultimate reality is not a person saying, oh, I'm setting you off and you are higher and lower. Ultimate reality is a principle. So you can't hold him responsible. When the ultimate reality manifests itself as human being or as living thing or the creation, there is variation because inevitable. Not because there is some horrible monster trying to do it. There's no evil or devil in Hinduism. It's just that when this thing manifests itself, it pays a price. Some are a little bit higher, some are a little bit lower. That is the most better philosophical response. Sorry about this disturbance. There's a two-man show here. So when you get this kind of philosophic challenge, always fall back on the principle of the Hinduism, which talks of Atman and Brahman, and go away from the idea of super personalities, because no super personality can respond to this challenging question.
In moving from the traditional version of Hinduism to the new modern contemporary version of Hinduism, how is it that the scriptures from the pandits and the pujaris are hindering this transition?
Very good issue. I'll be very honest. A couple of weeks ago, I was making fun saying that Yamraj, there cannot be one individual dark black person with a moustache sitting on a bull with a little man saying, okay, when you die, I come and thump you and take your soul away, especially your bedi. This is pure narrative, colorful narrative. There is no such individual collecting souls. Even though we have used it in all our scriptures, all our shastras, even the high philosophic shastras like Upanishad, Katopnisha talks of Yamdev, Yamraj. So you say, oh, it must be real. It's in your shastras. So one individual said, Mr. Lakhani, why are you challenging? There's no Yamraj. I say, I'm telling you it's a narrative. You say, but how can you make this? How can you decide? This is how you decide, my friend. I'm warning all our Hindu youngsters, think like this. Adi Shankara has given a beautiful way of relating to spirituality and religion. It says, Shruti, shastras. It's a good way to start. Say, it's in our shastra. Means shastra means kind of scripture that your religion has produced, shastra. So it's in the shastra. Start with that, no problem. But the next word he uses is very powerful. He says, yukti, shruti, yukti. Then use your common sense to make sense whether what you hear, how you interpret it is possible or not possible. We all have this thing called rationality. It's a great gift that God has given us. Or if you like this thing that we possess, manifests as rationality, don't underestimate it, don't undermine it. So anything that you hear in the name of religion, including from Mr. Lakhani, if it offends your common sense, reject it. So this young man said, I want to reject you, Mr. Lakhani. I can't believe that there's no Yamraj. I said, fine, reject it. You're allowed to think like this only in your tradition. And other religions, if you do that, they'll really ostracize you. In your religion, say, use your rational faculty. If anything doesn't appeal to your common sense, reject it, even if it's in the Shastra. So I am saying the idea of Yamraj that you see in the Shastra is something purely narrative. Don't get fixated. Think there's a literal person saying, I am your Yamraj. I'm coming with these little mates and thump you when you die. It's nonsense. It flies in the face of common sense. So always keep this thing fully switched on. Shruti, Shastra is fine, Yukti. Other thing initially I must bring in, because Shastra is a word that's been thrown in my face left, right and center. First of all, Shastra is just a kind of giving, if you like, a title to a particular way of looking at any particular enterprise. Sometimes we say geography, one Shastra, history, another Shastra, mathematics, another Shastra. In Hinduism, we say an Artha Shastra, we say Nyaya Shastra, we say Jyotish Shastra. We have given this kind of terminology to mean scriptures relating to that particular field of activity. We're fine with that. Again, the Shastras can be, if you like, philosophically oriented or can be ritually oriented, etc. But the most crucial factor that you must remember is this. The reason why the Hindu youngsters struggle with Hinduism is they are not prepared to move on. Shastras, all the Shastras, including the highest philosophy, says it comes with a sell-by date. If circumstances are changing, humanity is evolving, it can relate to spirituality in a different way. Allow for it. Don't say, no, it's written 2,000 years ago in this Shastra, Manusmuti. Don't do that. You are in trouble straight away. You are a living tradition. So the Shastra may have some interesting aspects to it, but don't get caught up by them. Rise above them. This is the important thing. Modern Shastra, I'll give one example. Manusmuti is ancient Shastra, okay, saying, okay, this is how human beings should behave. And then we have Shikshapati from the Swami Narayan. And this is a modern version of how human beings should behave. So, no, Manusmuti said, no, the modern one is the old face of Hinduism. Recognize it and subscribe to it rather than get caught up with antiquated stuff. And the most important feature regarding everything I say is use your rational faculty to suss out what appears real or not. Any system you adopt, if it's not well joined up, if the bits that are not reconciled within itself, throw it away. Because that is a jagged system. In science, we do the same.
Does not serve you at all.
If you approach any hypothesis which is not self-consistent, don't waste your time on it. It must be self-consistent. So even the religious ideas we have must be self-consistent for us to allow us to engage with it. So be aware of Shastras and their limitation and this ability to rise above it. And I'm rattling a lot of traditionalists, because traditionalists are stuck on the Shastra. Shastri said so. Then you go with your Shastri. Good luck to you. But I will not advocate it whatsoever.
One of the viewers has said, Mr. Lakhani, be honest. Do you support Modi ji because he is Gujarati, or is it because of his work, which does not seem to be visible?
Okay, first of all, this challenge that Modi ji faces in the political arena, that his work has not been visible, is quite true. A lot of things he promised he could not fulfill. The reason is very simple. He's dealing with a very stodgy system, highly corrupt system. Even in his own party, there are people who are corrupt. There's no doubt about it. So he's dealing with a very corrupt and difficult, very stodgy, difficult to shift. You know, the Hindu mentality is very full of inertia to shift. So he promised this and that and everything. We'll clear up the Ganga, we will give this and that to everybody. He's doing his best, he's pulling his hair out, poor man, he's hardly sleeping. So that is why I like him. First of all, there is no corruption in his system, not a single droplet. There is nobody, no politician in the world who can stand up to Modi when it comes to integrity and absolutely zero corruption. No, nobody in the whole world, I guarantee you that. Check it out. So this is the reason why I like him, not because he's a Gujarati. Gujaratis love money. This man doesn't want money. See the difference? He doesn't want it. He gives away his own salary to his children's charity or whatever. So I like him for that reason. The second reason why I like him is, look, he's in a way inspired by the same personality that I am inspired by. This modern giant called Vivekananda, he stirred up the nation. He made them saying, arise my India, arise my India. So he's this came with this clarion call. He killed himself literally, lived only to the age of 39, spent every moment of his last 20 years just focusing on presenting the deeper vision of Hinduism, not only in India, but throughout the world. And he planted the seeds of spirituality in other parts of the world, and they are now mushrooming. You see, when you see the modern England, you see this idea of egalitarian society, giving equal dignity to women, giving dignity to LG, you know, this lesbian gay movement. All these ideas are planted by Vivekananda, saying give dignity to human beings. Don't vilify anybody. Don't ostracize anybody. So these wonderful ideas are now springing up, not because there's a little movement saying, Mr. Vivekananda movement, he said so. It's just happening naturally and organically. That's how it should be. Not somebody tinkling bells and building temples in his name. His ideas must enter society, and this is happening. And with Narendra Modi, I see the same thing. The idea that Vivekananda planted has in a way stirred him up to do something for his nation without any personal expectation whatsoever. And that is why I like him, not because he's a Gujarati.
Are Hindus ignorant or innocent while they give statements like all gods or all paths lead to the same? Means talking about all other religions. And they're saying that other religions, the people who are part of that religion, they feel pride and they practice their religion strictly and hesitate to even consume prasad from our offering. So why is it that Hindus belittle themselves and expose themselves to conversion by being overly inclusive?
There's a risk. When you are kind of open-minded as we are, our tradition is open-minded. I can't snuff it out. I can't say, no, now become close-end like other traditions, saying this is the only path, this is the only God, repeat his name. You follow this book I wave in your face and follow it through the letter. Don't even argue about it. Don't interpret it. Don't even think about it. Just your thinking has been done for you. These are religions. So when they promote this thing, everything has been thought out for you, stop thinking. I say, I'm not interested in that tradition. And I tell our Hindu youngsters, if anybody comes and says, follow this book, is everything sorted out for you? Kick it away. Kick it away. Even if it's a Hindu book, kick it away. You must be allowed to think for yourself. Didn't I say this thing you possess called rationality is the best guide for you to regarding how you lead your religious life as well as secular life? Don't switch it off under any circumstances. So other traditions that come with this kind of very narrow vision, even in some Hindu tradition, we've got some cultish movement in Hinduism too. I say, you know, throw away this blinker division. Approach this idea of religion in a much more kind of broader manner, and this will give you a better handle on reality and yourself and other people and people of other religion, as well as most importantly people of no religion. They are the, I'm telling you, in a way, nation by secularism is one of the best kind of leveler, because in a way this idea of people different religions quarreling, secularism, forget all the religions, nuisance.
Yes.
Follow a secular model, just be a good human being straight away, see, it will appeal. So secularism is a great leveler. So in a way, how religions could unfold is they're going to kind of become more secularly oriented and slowly kick out all religions, including Hinduism. So the secular model we say is fine. The only thing is we say humanism is fine, but add this word called spiritual humanism, then you're back to Hinduism, the deeper vision of Hinduism. So it's an ongoing struggle, but I'm not saying we must compromise ourselves because we are laying ourselves open to a conversion. We just have to arm our youngsters with the depth of our tradition, the breadth of his vision, and I'm promising you nobody will come near them to convert them. To the contrary, they'll run away thinking they'll get converted because we are such a broad system of thought. So my experience is, why should I give up this broad vision of Hinduism, which is so comprehensive and so kind of inclusivist, and adopt a very exclusivist and narrow blinkered vision that you are promoting in my face? I'm not going to accept it. That's how the Hindus should react.
In those who believe in possession, what is possessed? If Atma is eternal, what happens in purported cases of possession and the belief of possession in different cultures?
Very good. Very good. You see, first of all, Atman, I've made this distinction. Atman and Jivatman are two different things altogether. Atman is a spirit that is never here. It's the real, your true nature. That cannot be blemished, that cannot be possessed. It's already possessed. It's Atman, it's self-possessed, if I can use the word. Jivatman, that means the individualized individual saying, I'm me, I'm a human being. That is, if you like, an appearance of Atman in this body and mind frame. And that Jivatman is open to these kind of issues, because then the Jivatman is, in a way, if you like, an appearance of Atman in this mind and body frame. And I'm not very keen on developing or delving too much into this particular subject, but it is possible that there are other Jivatman who are very keen to impose themselves on a particular another Jivatman and in a way make them, use them as their machines. I dislike it thoroughly. So if somebody says, I'm getting possessed by the great God or goddesses, I say, no good. Even gods and goddesses will not possess you whatsoever. You are an individual, flow in your own way. Somebody once said, Mr. Lakhani, the way you are speaking, it seems as if Vivekananda is speaking through. I say, I hate him. Then if he does it, I'll kick him out. I don't want anybody to possess me, including Vivekananda. I will be my own original person in my own limited way to continue progress further. So possession is not something that we encourage. We would say run away from it immediately and be strong enough to say nobody can possess me. It's not only true for Hindus, it's true for all traditions. This possession is worldwide and I believe it is possible, but I'm saying run away from it whatsoever. Don't allow anybody to infringe on your individuality by saying, I'm now going to use your mouth to speak through, etc. Or take over your mind. Don't you dare allow anybody to do that. Your dignity is compromised. Don't do that.
What is pluralism?
Yes. You see, look at humanity, forget about religion, world religion, whole of humanity, since we were born, all of us for thousands of years, we are in search of our identity, really think that's what it's all about. We don't know who the heck are we. We first of all look in the mirror and say, that's me, surely. You look at your body and say, that's me. So we kind of get fixated on what we think we are. And this, in a way, you're trying to unfold, get your identity. So we use different pathways to discover our true identity. That's all. The world is the, even if you're a secular person, you are trying to identify yourself with the hype that you've been discussing. I must be rich and I must make money. And that's the identity you create for yourself and live up to the hype and feel smug when you achieve that. So we are kind of all the time struggling to sort ourselves out. What is our true nature? What is our true identity? Now this process is called unfolding spiritually. Now different individuals have unfold spiritually using different methods. Is there anything wrong with it? No. It depends on your own background, your family background, your cultural background, that you unfold in a particular mode. So many people have been brought up or weaned. For example, you know, Nishit Bhai have been weaned, or even me was weaned on a Hindu tradition. So this idea of gods and goddesses and colorful narratives is the way we are weaned, brought to, towards our religion. So we find our identity through using that particular format. Every tradition, suppose you are a Christian or a Muslim, you will kind of in a way unfold your, give your identity based on your tradition, saying, oh, you are this and you are loved by God and you must find God. So that's the identity you create for yourself and try and fulfill the hype with that particular method. This is called pluralism. Different individuals unfolding spiritually in the mode that suits their own temperament, their background, their cultural, social background, allow for it. Even a secular person, says Richard Dawkins, he's not bothered with religion. In fact, he dislikes the word religion. He's in a way unfolding spiritually using the faculty that he loves most, biology, evolutionary biology, and sees he can get answers to the deeper question regarding what is our identity, what's the identity of human beings or living things using biology. So it's unfolding in a particular mode. So this is called pluralism, many different ways to unfold spiritually based on our own temperament, our own background, our own, you know, cultural, social. Remember, recognize it, don't vilify it. That is why it's called pluralism, many ways to unfold spiritually. There's a real deeper meaning the word pluralism.
In over the years, as you look back in history, whenever some major discovery was made, it is usually a person who is either a genius or is insane. So my question is this: where is the difference between insanity and genius?
None. There's none. Actually, they're on the same cusp of the same. I'll give an example. There's a nice way to explore this. You see, a great mathematician called Bernard Russell, an English mathematician, decided in order to grasp reality, see how well he's thinking, clear thinker, let me create a system of logic whereby I can completely understand the whole of creation. So the system of logic must be self-consistent. There shouldn't be little jagged pieces, and complete, must incorporate the whole of the creation, mental, intellectual, you know, physical world. Everything can be captured through my system of logic. What a clever way. He's thinking, can I use mathematics to capture the essence of the whole of the reality? This is what he tried. Yeah, I think he spent 20, 30 years producing material, you know. It'll give you a headache, by the way, if you try and read it. Principia Mathematica or something is called. But I get a headache when I looked at it. So he spent his whole life almost trying to produce this system of logic which is self-consistent and complete. He seems to be getting very close to the end after a lot of years of hard work. And then one nutter, this is the word I'm using, that's why I say nut. Nuts can be very close to being really kind of high intellectual giants, called Kurt Gödel, a Belgian mathematician, who was almost nutty, came up with a simple resolution saying it is impossible to create any system of logic that is both complete and self-consistent. You can't have it, he said. And it did a simple GCSE mathematics, and he threw it in the face of Bernard Russell. And straight away, the whole of this poor Russell's work was gone, demolished in 1 minute. So a nutter destroyed the poor, you know, grand master of mathematics in 2 ticks. With simple GCSE mathematics, you can't produce any system of logic that is both self-consistent and, you know, and complete, all-encompassing. Yeah. The reason why it failed was this. When you try and include infinity or infinitesimal, creates hell. That doesn't play a role with the finite. And this is where the disjoint happens. And that is why he destroyed it completely. And this, by the way, this Kurt Gödel, in later years, was put in a mental home. But you see, so you said the geniuses and the nutters are not very far from each other. They think outside the box. Both of them think outside the box. That is why they appear very similar. And one other thing I must say is this. This idea of mathematics in a way is very good because it tells us why Hinduism is so magnanimous. It says, however grand may be your intellectual gymnastics, you cannot capture the essence of reality. Medhaya means intellect. So you see, if you try and capture the essence of Brahman, this is what he was trying to do. Bernard Russell was trying to do, capture essence of Brahman using logic. He said, logic will fail. Hmm. But it's called Gödel proved him right, proved that idea right. So they are digressive, but it's interesting.
Om Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om.
Free e-learning course in Hinduism. To register, please visit www.hindu-academy.com.
Talks on Hinduism, sponsored by People Care, encouraging caring for the elderly in their own homes. For more information, please visit peoplecare.com.